What was it that attracted you to revolutionary politics?
What drew me to revolutionary politics was, I'd have to say, the sheer fact that they were revolutionary. That I could feel, I was born in 1949, so I was almost the perfect age to be at university in 1968. And to have become very outraged by a number of things, principally the Vietnam War, but not alone that. And to be very discontented, as many people were for different reasons, with the boring post-war, partly social democratic, partly conservative consensus. So, in a sense, the sheer promiscuity of the word revolution, I have to say, had some attraction to me. I think it's worth remembering that in 1968, at the height of what we thought of as, and I still do think of as, the appalling aggression accompanied by chemical destruction of its environment and people and other appalling things of Vietnam, in the United States, the Democrats were in power, in some ways quite liberal Democrats. In Great Britain, the Labour Party was in power. In what was then still Western Federal Germany, there was a grand coalition of social democrats. In other words, if you wanted to oppose from the left, you had to go quite a long way to the left, because a sort of official left was already there. I think that context might be important. But it was more than anything else that actually, with what I think of still as a sense of history that I can sometimes call on, I actually felt one was entering a revolutionary period. I'll say quickly. The rejection by black America, often violent rejection, of its long condition of servitude. Very dramatic. The takeover in the middle of Mediterranean democratic Europe, Greece, with all its metaphors of democracy and so forth, by a right-wing military dictatorship protected by NATO. The war in Indochina. The way in which white Rhodesia was allowed to get away with a rebellion against the crown by what seemed to us a spineless regime. The extraordinary stirrings in Latin America, which had for long been a kind of backyard of American empire. A number of other things. And then, as the year rolled by and mounted, a social rebellion that nearly put an end to de Gaulle's Fifth Republic, which was long overdue to be put to sleep anyway. And in Poland and in Czechoslovakia, the very, very interesting stirrings, very intelligible to those of us who thought we were Trotskyists, supported the left opposition tradition of intellectual and working class opposition to Stalinism. So, you know, one would hear speakers saying we might be living through another 1848 or even another 1917 or 18. And it didn't seem all that much of an exaggeration. It took a long time. One had to live a while to realize that what I was actually seeing was the end of a long stretch of the European left.
Today, when people talk about revolution, what do you think the revolution is now? Or is there still one to be had?
I was asked to give a talk at the American University of Beirut a couple of years ago. In fact, you were there. About who are the revolutionaries in the Middle East now. And I had to do it in the teeth of some rather unappetizing audience members who are sympathizers of either Hezbollah or, more likely on that campus, the Syrian National Socialist Party, equally, not equally, but comparably disgusting group and so on. And also speaking against a kind of culture of anti-Americanism on that campus. Yeah. So to me, the revolutionaries in the Middle East now are the people who are trying to replace the Islamic Republic of Iran, putting their own lives right onto the street against a very ruthless regime, to transform a theocracy into something that's more appropriate to govern an ancient civilization like Persia that's defamed and befouled by this clerical fascist regime. And the people who've striven with increasing success to create an independent Kurdistan in northern Iraq, or an autonomous Kurdistan that might lead to stirrings, has already led to stirrings in Syria, Turkey, Iran, and elsewhere, among the oldest oppressed minority in the Middle East and the largest people in the world who don't have a state of their own, a cause much longer and in some ways more venerable than the Palestinian one. And I went on in that vein. Those are revolutionaries to me, and it's been, by extension, I would have said before then, the people who asked for so little in Eastern Europe up to 1989. It was revolutionary to demand something like a Bill of Rights modeled on the American Constitution. That was a revolutionary demand. And my conclusion roughly was, and is, if you want to shorthand it, that the American Revolution is probably, with its separation of powers, separation of church and state, guarantee of free expression, and other celebrated triumphs of the Enlightenment, is the only revolution, the model of which is still left.
When did you realize that the Soviet Union was irredeemable as a political force in the world?
Until I was born in 1949, yeah. And I grew up thinking of the Soviet Union as irredeemable. I mean, I had read Darkness at Noon, for example, Arthur Koestler's masterpiece novel about Stalin's show trials, on my own, and I'd been given 1984 to read. I would have read it anyway in my school curriculum. And when I was seven, it's one of the first times I remember watching the news. In 1956, the two great international events were the doomed British invasion of Egypt with France and Israel, and the Hungarian Revolution and the repression by the Red Army of a popular revolt within a European capital city, with tanks. You see it on the TV. So I was one of those fortunate people, I suppose, didn't have any illusions to lose in the Soviet Union, and you regarded it with plain horror as a ramshackle, corrupt, dangerous empire, but one that wouldn't last for very long. I never believed that it could survive its political. But that would be easy to do. I mean, in other words, any fool could do that who could read a book against Stalinism. But in experience as well as theory, I was in Cuba in 1968, in the run-up to the invasion of Czechoslovakia, as it then was. And I knew quite a number of the Czech student leaders and others who were trying to declare their own independence from the Warsaw Pact, from Russian domination of Eastern Europe, because the Russian Empire is slightly different from the Soviet Union, but coextensive with it. And I thought the Russians were going to invade. I didn't see what choice they'd have. They couldn't let it go. But nor did I think could they invade without completely, as if you like, losing their credit, that would be the end of it. And I took part in various arguments that took place in Cuba, in Havana, during that week in August, including Fidel Castro's endorsement. And then you could still meet people, reasonable people who are still members of the Communist Party in Western Europe. I knew quite a lot of them. Their whole expression changed, you know, from then on. It was as if their main spring had broken. Mm. It often took them a long time actually to leave. But I can't remember anyone joining after that, for example. I just remember thinking, I've seen the end of it. I don't know how long it's going to take. It took 20 years, but it's over. That was, if you like, more demonstration than one needed for the situation.
There's a part in your memoir where you talk about your experience with Kolakowski. Where you disagree on whether or not communism can be reformed.
Yes.
And he was right in the end, wasn't he?
And wrong. Yeah, I was very fortunate when I was young to meet Leszek Kolakowski, national hero in Poland still. He died, I think, now only 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. Had been a so-called reform communist of the 50s generation. Had eventually been forced out of Poland by the repression in 1968, came to Oxford, where I then was. Wrote a magisterial history, not just of communism in practice, but of Marxism as a theory. It's still the best, most exhaustive critique of Marxist theory of history ever written. And Leszek, having been through these experiences, would tend to poo-poo any news of stirrings of reform or protest. And don't bring me any more news of reform communism, of hopeful shoots here and there. He said, it's an irredeemable system. It's beyond reform. Well, I thought that was true, but there still could be reformed communists, which there were, of whom Mikhail Gorbachev was obviously the most salient example. And that precisely because it was beyond reform, even a fairly tentative attempt to reform it would do the job, would bring in the roof. And so it's a nuance of a difference. But Leszek was too much unimpressed by developments like that by the end of his life. He was too wedded to pessimism. I hope I don't offend anyone watching who admired him as I did. Rudolf Barrow, for example, East German Marxist who went to jail after the invasion of Czechoslovakia and wrote a critique of the East German state, almost perfectly predicting the date on which it would collapse. when I showed Lajek this book, Barrow's book, in the late 70s, he said, basically, don't bother me with this. I mean, Barrow is still a Marxist. He can't have anything of interest to say on these questions. I was sure he was wrong, and I don't think I was wrong to point that out.
So your views on America have changed, I would say, over the years.
Well, of course, the biggest single revision that all of this, excuse me, certainly the biggest single revision that all of this has involved for me and has a part in all the other ones is revisiting one's view of the United States, yep. Yes. I was having a discussion the other day in London during a debate over the liberation of Iraq where I was speaking against some American liberals and with a friend of mine who until quite recently had been a member of the British Communist Party. And we had taken the side of Jalal Talabani and Bahram Saleh and Kanan Makir and the other Iraqi left and secular revolutionary intellectuals that the Saddam Hussein regime had to go, that no policy was conceivable that allowed it to retain private ownership of Iraq. I would have thought a pretty easy case to make. And my friend, a recently ex-communist friend, in the debate said, look, I know what all the criticisms of American imperialism are, and I've made them myself, and I could add the same with my book on Henry Kissinger's crimes and so forth. But if there is going to be a superpower or a hyperpower in global affairs, I'm very glad, he went on to say, that it's the United States and not any of the possible rivals. Well, that's common sense to me, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, you wrote a book 20 years ago about the Anglosphere.
Yes.
Which was more critical than perhaps it would be today. What's changed that makes the concept more palatable to you?
Well, I still think, which is what my book was about, that the more or less direct succession by American policy and institutions after 1945 of British imperial responsibilities wasn't a good thing for the United States, and not that good a thing for the territories that it inherited either. I'd mentioned the disputed territories that were still there at the end of the empire, Palestine, Cyprus, Kashmir, so on the border lines which we're still fighting over, as a matter of fact. Well, I don't think it was an admirable or fortunate thing that that happened, nor, in fact, the American succession in other parts of the world to the empires of Portugal in Africa, Belgium in Africa, Holland and Indonesia and elsewhere. That these are very, very spotty periods indeed, and I think deserve maybe more criticism than they got. But everything has to do with the alternative. And now that there isn't what you could call an idealistic, internationalist, secular, leftist opposition to this globally, there's nothing of the kind, it becomes much plainer who the real rivals are. So I would say, for example, that certainly the cruelest master Zimbabwe has ever had, a country where I was very much involved at one point when it was still Rhodesia, is not just Mugabe locally, but its imperial boss, his imperial boss, China, is by far the cruelest master of Zimbabwe.
Of course.
And if you make that extension, which is unhappily easy to do, to Darfur, Burma, North Korea, there's quite a long list. Mm-hmm. May have left something out. Everywhere where human rights are not just denied, but literally negated. Mm-hmm. The superpower of China is behind it. And blood for oil is the simplest way, for once. Simplicity works in this case, of encapsulating it. And one misses the idea that there's an American willingness to resist this. Though there is some, it feels faint, and one wishes it to be stronger.
You've written a lot about the, sort of the Eastern sin of communism, but also the Western sin of imperialism. Do you think it's easy to lump these together, and are there distinctions that need to be made between the two and also within imperialism? Was the British Empire as bad or nasty as the Belgian Empire was?
Well, if you ask me to compare and contrast progress made by imperialisms or as opposed to retrogressive things done by them, my favorite writing on this always was and still is Karl Marx's brilliant essays on India, where he said, it's absurd to go on about the British oppression or occupation of India because it's not as if India would be unoccupied without the British. It would be now dominated either by Russia possibly Turkey, conceivably China. Persia. Not then, I think, China, yeah. but that doesn't invalidate the right. same point. And he said the British Empire is undoubtedly using India for what I would call extractive reasons, converting its people and raw materials into capital without very much concern in order to finance the British Industrial Revolution. Nonetheless, this has brought to India, he enumerates them, the railway, the printing press, he thought that was of the highest importance, the telegraph, and steamship communication with other cultures. It's ended the millennial stagnation and isolation of India. But all of this is to the benefit of the Indian people, and it also means in the end they will be able to have their own modern, relatively modern, prosperous, post-British state. Actually, that's not only was it the correct analysis at the time, which left out nothing by way of a critique of the way the British treated their subjects, but objectively it was quite a good predictor of what India is now. Yeah. The British record in Ireland doesn't strike me that way at all. I mean, and parts of West Africa and elsewhere. I don't think one can say that it harnessed the energies, emancipated the labor force and savings or any of this sort of thing as it did in India.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope my accent doesn't betray me or compromise me, but I still think, a good case to be made, if you have to be colonized, don't be colonized by the Belgians, of course. For one thing, it's a terrible thing to be colonized by a country that's already practically a colony itself and backward and impoverished and narrow. And best of all, is to have your own free economy and free institutions and an alliance with other countries that have the same. The Anglosphere is a prefiguration of that, I suppose. Rather imperfect, rather inexact, but not bad.
Mm. The least bad of the.
And it would, and just to give you an example of how the promptings of the left don't leave me, or I don't think can be left out of this either. South Africa wasn't, in fact, English speaking entirely. It was an Afrikaner dominated and Dutch run. Totalitarian system, in my opinion, because I think racism is totalitarianism by definition, run by people whose party leadership had actually been on the other side in the Second World War. And I would say, if I'd been asked as late as the 1970s, a worse place to live in and a worse disgrace to human values than, say, Cuba was, or even is now.
South Africa.
Yes. So that there aren't the separations aren't all that easy but to make. They're not that difficult either.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would have added, and I should have said it already, I always thought, and I still think, that a nuclear war would be worse than any possible political outcome. It would be totalitarianism defined for the survivors. It would be back to the most appalling tyranny of scarcity and famine and want and ruin. That's self-evident, but it would also be the end not just of our generation, but of all the generations that have come before us to build civilization. And so my anxiety to avoid anything that could lead to what was pathetically, wickedly, I thought, euphemistically called a nuclear exchange was very strong and still is. And one would, in the better dead than red calculus, have no difficulty at all deciding. And don't forget, there were people at that time who honestly did think that the risk of that was worth running for Cuba. For heaven's sake, even for Vietnam in the 50s. And then I thought, was the spirit of fascism transmuted into the discourse of the West, and I was very much against it, and I don't regret that one bit.
Well, since we're on that topic, do you think a nuclear Iran can be contained?
No. I don't think, actually, a theocratic Iran can be contained even without nuclear weapons. I think there's a confrontation in our future between our civilization, I'll say that without embarrassment, the world that at least respects, if it doesn't always practice, the rule of law, and that has devised certain forms of diplomacy and certain systems of arms control to which the Iranians are legally signatories, and a regime that has the clearly expressed ambition to break out of and to trample all those conventions. We already see it in the threats to their Arab Sunni neighbors in countries like Bahrain, in their export of violence, as far away as murdering Jewish community leaders in Argentina, or Kurdish exiles in Berlin and Vienna, for heaven's sake, or a novelist friend of mine living in London writing fiction. I think they've asked for a fight and should know that on those conditions they certainly will get one. I was at a Hezbollah rally, well, so yeah. were you, in Beirut a little while ago, and I couldn't but notice that the party symbol of Iran's main client in that country, Hezbollah, is now a nuclear mushroom cloud. In cartoon form, the cartoon is made up of words which, when decoded, constitute a threat to the Jewish state, the Jewish people. Well, I wouldn't want to look back and think, I wonder if I should have paid attention to a threat like that. You may say one is alarmist. I could give you also all the reasons why that could be a bluff. They don't have it. They just want you to think they do. It's a way of aggrandizing themselves. I know that's all partly true, too. But behind it, there's a reality. And the reality would be the emergence of a thermonuclear theocracy. The one thing we've, since I was at school, been lying awake worrying about, what happens when apocalyptic weaponry is grabbed hold of, laid hold of, by messianic totalitarian forces. Well, we are about to find out. If we want to run that experiment, they're ready to do it for us.
So that's the worst. There are no consequences of an
attack. No consequences could possibly be worse than that, because I'm not one of those who thinks they would immediately use it on the Israelis, let alone on the United States. I think they want it for purposes of blackmail, principally against other Muslims and non-Persians in the region, or at least initially. The mullahs have a great racket, bleeding their country dry and running it into the ground and sucking out the surplus. Most of them don't want to give it up. But it doesn't mean that a later regime wouldn't be much more extreme, and they'd have the same weapons. So we have to take that into account. But in the meanwhile, we'd have to live in a world where, perforce, we were polite and accommodating and agreeable to these characters. And I decline to live on those terms. I won't do it. The best speech made by Churchill on the most overused example, of course, of this kind of compromise. But still, I think the best and one of the least known, as he finally said in one speech, is it's not that one objects particularly to any one policy, internal or external, of the Hitlerite regime. It's that you basically don't want to live on the same continent as them. You don't want to be breathing the same air. And in the long run, in fact, you aren't going to be able to. One of you is going to have to yield. There is, and I think should be, so I'm glad there is, a radical incompatibility between a civilized world order, which aspires at any rate to democracy and free exchange, and totalitarian, expansionist, fanatical regimes.
Did the overthrow of Saddam Hussein strengthen the Iranian regime, or is that question moot if they're simply next on the list?
If I was asked if the overthrow of the Saddam Hussein regime had the effect of strengthening the Iranian one, I think I'd have at least two or three replies. One would have to be yes in the short term. It gives it access to an audience of co-religionists within Iraq, who are by no means its puppets, but over whose leadership it does exert influence, not all of it financial, but some of it. On the other hand, it gives them the knowledge that on their near abroad frontier, as with their Afghan one, there are forces that are keeping an eye on them, namely ours, and we're as near to them as they are to us, if you see what I mean. Bear that in mind, too. I have some reason to think, from talking to Iranian dissidents, both in Iran, where I've been, and in the diaspora, that when the Iranian people see free elections taking place in which Shia voters, they're not all as sectarian as that, but let's just keep it to that, and Shia parties compete against one another, they're not completely unimpressed. They don't want anyone to think, of course, that they would take an Arab country as a model. No Persian would ever allow that. But the free press, the satellite dishes and cell phones and the rest of it, these are unquantifiable. Well, that's harder to judge than the immediate influence exerted by Ahmadinejad on some Iraqi client. But they deserve to be mentioned too, and I think could equally be, not more equally be, could be more in influential in the long run. Second, do we wish to go back to a time when Jimmy Carter was encouraging Saddam Hussein to rearm in order that he could invade Iran, apparently to do the United States a favor, in a war that failed to bring down the Khomeini regime, did strengthen the Saddam Hussein regime, did strengthen dictatorial tendencies in Iran, and not incidentally took the lives of perhaps 1.5 million people and beggared off. No, I mean, this playing off of Iran against Iraq is one of the foulest parts of our recent statecraft. What one wants is to end it by putting both countries in the control of their own people. And that might sound simplistic, but it could not possibly be worse than the competing dictatorship calculus which we operated on before.
So there's no point at which the consequences of the Iraq war would outweigh the benefits?
No, certainly not. Because apart from anything else, it's invariably a good thing to see Caligula on trial in front of his own people, with Milosevic, with Charles Taylor of Liberia, the invader and attempted genocide in Sierra Leone, where we prevented another Rwanda from taking place. Tony Blair getting, I think, particular credit for that in West Africa. And with the humiliation, I would happily call it, of Saddam Hussein in front of the people who he tortured and murdered and ruined for so long, and others too. No, one can't wish that undone, of course. And furthermore, not a small thing, we can now certify Iraq as in compliance with UN resolutions on weapons of mass destruction, which couldn't before. That's, by the way, that's a game. Yeah. Not knowing, not being able to certify, is a great source of insecurity and instability, by the way, as well as an outrageous breach of international law.
In that neighborhood, Turkey, do you think they'll ever be ready to join the EU?
No, I don't now. Sorry, I would have once said that I looked forward, not without misgiving, to Turkish membership of the European Union, and certainly was against some of the reasons given for opposing it, such as by His Holiness the Pope at one stage, who said that openly that a country that had Muslim culture was by definition not European. That's not true, or we better hope it's not true, say, of Bosnia and Herzegovina. And Kosovo, which we liberated from an attempt at their extirpation by Christian fascists, and something I'm very proud of having advocated. But the problem with Turkey, I think, is a somewhat different one. At least under its new leadership, it's already becoming the originator of unusual demands on the European family of nations. For example, at a NATO meeting, held not very long ago, where it had been decided that all the members of NATO wanted as their next spokesman, Andreas Rasmussen of Denmark. It had been agreed. At the last minute, the Turks veto it and say, we cannot have as head of NATO someone who isn't willing to censor his own press, something Danish law forbids, in the matter of some cartoons in a paper in Jutland. Well, this is unacceptable. That's how they behave before they're in Europe. I don't like to think how they would behave when in. So a friend of mine has a very rough way of putting this, but once I've said it, you won't be able to forget it either. He said, when did you last read a report from Istanbul that didn't describe Turkey as a bridge between East and West? You can't not read it, especially if it's about Istanbul. Mm-hmm. Orhan Pamuk does it. His novel's all about it. Turkish intellectuals and journalists begin their addresses to Western think tanks that way. Said my friend, it's not a bridge, it's a tunnel. Now forget that. European Union's borders will be with Iran and Iraq, actually with some of the better bits of Iraq, northern Kurdish autonomous Iraq, but we don't know for sure what can be imposed or inflicted on that area too in the future. It's not inspiring.
There's sort of an irony though, because in many ways the party in power now is more democratic. The Kemalists are more illiberal in many ways, yet they're also secular. So where do you find your place to plant your flag?
Well, in some respects, the Kemalist secularists were more chauvinistic than than Mr. Erdogan's party, which at least in its early days showed signs of being somewhat more flexible, especially on the Kurdish question, very important. There is another people, non-Turkish, who dwell in Anatolia. It's taken the Turks a long time to admit it, but they have begun to, and some strides of that kind of thing. But it may just be the personality of Mr. Erdogan himself, but he's a bully. And I'm not sure how tightly wrapped he is either. By that I mean he goes into tantrums. He picked. No one dislikes Shimon Peres, perhaps more than I do. But the fight that was picked in public with him by Mr. Erdogan at Davos, was purely vulgar and thuggish and opportunist. The remarks he made on the commemoration of the Armenian genocide in April earlier this year were scandalous. He said if the United States Congress didn't cease troubling him on the matter, which we're obliged to do, I think, but he would deport the remaining Armenians, ones who still do live in Turkey, who have come there as workers from the Armenian Republic neighboring. Extraordinary. Imagine any other European leader saying that about a national minority.
He denied that Bashir is a mass murderer.
Well, he's...
He said no Muslim could commit...
His relations with Iran are far too sickly and warm, as with China. And it is possible that the Ergenekon trial, this massive show trial that's now being brought nearer to a court in Turkey, is the unmasking of a reactionary military Kemalist plot. There have been plots to overthrow the elected government in Turkey before from that quarter. It's possible that that is so, but it's also possible that it's an occasion to shut down all dissent. And I would not want to say that I was confident. It wasn't the latter. And certainly a man who has openly said, while running for office, that democracy is like getting on a bus or a train. You ride it till you get to where you want to go, and then you get off. Some form of coded reassurance, I suppose, to the more unreconstructed Islamists in his electorate. But I don't like the sound of that either. So for now, I think I mentioned this concept before, since one's always going to regret one outcome, there's no possibility of not having a regret, whichever choice one takes. I think I'd rather regret keeping Turkey out of the European Union than regret having it in, with a veto power.
So we're 2 years now into the Obama administration. Has there been any reset with Russia? Do you see any benefits from this policy so far?
The Obama administration prefers to explain its policy towards Putin and his Russia, which is what it is, as a reset. And I would be more impressed if there was a little bit more to show for this. For example, it's said that Russia's become recently a little more cooperative in the matter, say, of the Iranian sanctions. Not very much more. And those gestures of cooperation are more than compensated for on the other side by Russian overtures, directly actually to the Iranian nuclear program and offers to help it, in fact. And I regard that as the crucial test of Russian resetting. On the arms control agreement, well, that's more the price of it than the policy itself. The arms control agreement, I've seen persuasive argument, might be worth having for its own sake. But if it isn't, it's not worth having for the good behavior that Mr. Putin's displayed so far, either at home or abroad.
Do you still believe in the notion of a nuclear-free world? This has been articulated by the president as a policy, do you think that's feasible or desirable?
When the president got his good behavior Nobel Prize, in other words, the prize that you get in the hope you will do something with peace rather than a whole new concept, an Oscar in the hope that you'll make a decent film one day. Maybe a good idea, actually, better than the rewards for the terrible films that have been written. One of the soggy and regrettable things he said was he looked forward to a nuclear-free world. At any rate, it's the sort of thing people do say when they go to Stockholm, and I feel sure he did that, and has on other occasions. There are two distinctions to be made here. One is that of, if you like, uninventing the idea of thermonuclear weapons. Some people who talk about nuclear-free world almost seem to wish that that could be done. In fact, seem explicitly to wish that there weren't even nuclear reactors. Bizarre. In common with a lot of green talk, expresses a nostalgia for a pre-industrial, pre-modern society. Agrarian relations were more simple and more warm and human, for which I've no nostalgia at all. But I don't take any stock in any of that, but I think the bullets can be taken out of the gun and the gun put in a drawer. I mean, we are still in a condition not very far from launch on warning, a war that could break out for no reason. Was a misunderstanding or a panic or even a technical punch. I find that an appalling way to be living. I can't believe we can't improve on that. And it would be much better, therefore, much superior to say specifically how one could live without the curse and the fear of a nuclear annihilation. than to talk in arm-waving terms about, that involve just throwing the word nuclear with the word free together in a sentence.
Mm-hmm. On this question of Russia, do you think that some societies are not suited, or at least for the foreseeable future, to have democracy? Or is this the soft bigotry of low expectations?
Well, again, to revert to my favorite 19th century analyst and journalist and columnist, Karl Marx and his devoted sidekick, Friedrich Engels. I've published essays about both these aspects. When they weren't being brilliant about the future of British India, they were unusually shrewd about the future of the United States, which they thought to be the great country for free labor, untrammeled social mobility, innovation, and many other positively charged things. In contrast to the frightful millennial backwardness and despotism of Russia that seemed almost impervious to mm-hmm. human effort. It's the view that many great Russian writers have taken mm-hmm. of their culture. I simply don't feel entitled to pronounce on that. But one reason, I haven't been to Russia enough, I've only been there once. I've read a lot of its writers and writing, and I can understand the idea of the pessimistic Russian soul readily enough, given their history. I think the reason I'd want to resist it is because it makes something like the current Putin regime seem like the best they can do. Well, that's plainly not the case. I mean, a country in far worse straits materially than Russia could do a great deal better than the regime of personal power, in which, for some reason, there seems to be a law that says it must be true, but anyone who criticizes the regime goes missing or is mutilated or silenced in some form or another, in which there's what I consider to be a very dangerous alliance between Russian nationalism and chauvinism, revived under various pretexts of humiliation that I think are very dubious, and a very dogmatic reactionary Russian Orthodox Church, which has now become the clerical garb in which, in all public ceremonies, Putinism is draped, very reminiscent, in fact, of pre-1917 Tsarism. And for that reason, to be deplored as a terrible outcome for the Russian people and for people who live within Russia's borders, who are non-Russian, but also for Russia's neighbors, because this expresses a clear nostalgia for days of Russian glory and domination and empire.
Do you think the United States or its allies should make contingent security arrangements with the small countries in Russia's periphery, or is that not worth the trouble, like Georgia or the Baltics?
If I'm asked what responsibility this gives us, the menace of a recrudescent nationalist, expansionist, reactionary Russia, with its periphery or its near abroad, as it's sometimes called, I think certainly in the case of the Baltic republics, were annexed by the Soviet Union as part of the Hitler-Stalin Pact, and finally pried loose from that only in the last days of Gorbachev, and confirmed as independent states very recently. I think that's a clear responsibility on our part to prevent any bullying in that case. And I think that the Poles can certainly claim to be able to look after themselves and look as if they probably can. There's a lot of Russian meddling in the Czech Republic, I was about to say Czechoslovakia, which I don't like the sound of. And then, of course, there's a very outstanding case of Georgia, which keeps describing itself, or its present leadership does, as sort of more Western than we are, more committed to our values than we seem to be, clearly with the hope that we will take that literally, as David Cameron did during the recent conflict, and sort of fly to Tbilisi and declare for Georgia. I don't know, I'd want to know a lot more about Georgian internal dynamics before I'd commit to that.
Just one question on Afghanistan. Have you lost hope in that? Is that intractable?
Again, look, there are countries where we are responsible, whether we wish to be or not, where we've incurred responsibility. And there are countries where we haven't. And I think that's a good distinction to make at the outset. What happened in Rwanda, I believe we could have done more to prevent through the United Nations, but it wasn't something wasn't a crisis or a misery or a potential catastrophe that we had created. It was our job to do more than we did. We shouldn't have vetoed the Czech resolution at the United Nations that called just for the strengthening of the UN protective force in Kigali. We even opposed that. But as I say, it wasn't something where you had to say to every American, look, whether you know it or not, this is our responsibility. Well, with Afghanistan, you can't say that. Or rather, if you like, you can. I mean, we involved ourselves in the Afghan war against the Soviet Union very deeply. We picked some not very desirable allies at that point, for good reasons of realpolitik, or bad if you want. Then we walked away from the country and let it collapse in civil war and factionalism, and worse, the final worst possible combination of both chaos and tyranny, an Islamic Republic. Manages to get the worst of both worlds. Hobbesian state with iron rules. Means we've got more reasons than the Taliban to have to undo this and repay some of what we owe to the Afghan people. And that would be true, I think, even if it was not in our interest. Again, with Iraq, we have an ineffaceable responsibility there. The CIA has boasted in the past of helping Saddam Hussein get to power. I have reason to think that boast is probably partly true. We certainly encouraged Saddam Hussein to attack Iran. We declared ourselves neutral in advance when he said he wanted to have a border dispute with Kuwait. This can't be walked away from. Americans like to say, well, what have we got to do with this place on the other side of the world? Well, this is what we have to do with it. So Afghanistan certainly belongs on that list of countries where we have a responsibility, whether we like it or not. There was once a moment in the 1950s in the British Parliament when the British government had said very unwisely that it wanted to hold on to the island of Cyprus, the whole island of Cyprus, as a colony because of its strategic importance and because of the bases that the British Empire had there, which command the approaches to the Suez Canal and to Palestine. And there was a national rebellion against this by the Greek majority, and a large British garrison had to be kept there to keep them down. And Aaron Bevan, the great socialist orator of the Labour Party left opposition at that time, got up and asked the government at question time, has Her Majesty, I can't do his Welsh voice, has Her Majesty's government considered whether it wants a base in Cyprus or Cyprus as a base? And I'm told that people who saw that could see the expressions change on the face of the government. They realized we don't have to run and own the whole place in order to have a presence there. And within actually a very short time, they'd withdrawn, written a constitution, given Cyprus independence, and the condition for it was that two bases remain permanently part of under British control. Not perfect, but a huge improvement. Well, we don't have to appoint the government of Afghanistan or be responsible for its writ running. But there's never been a government of Afghanistan whose writ has run all across the country. I very much doubt there ever will be one. It certainly won't be with the Karzai regime. But it's entirely possible to make life unbearable for the Taliban if we fight more as guerrillas, for example. If they take over an area, we let them run it for a bit. You know what will happen. Apart from anything else, anyone who can leave will, and in our direction, make their lives impossible. Fight them with subversive tactics. We, among other things, have a very strong interest in continuing to train a cadre of people, as does every other NATO country, who are used to this kind of fighting in these kind of conditions, and be able to conduct it very ruthlessly. Because we're going to need it again, a lot. And I think it's important to keep engaged, and if you like, it sounds heartless, keep blooded. Because this war is not going to end until one or the other of us has given up. So, to use it as a training ground for the smashing and massacre of jihad, to use it as an example of how Afghans could live, especially their women folk, but also their national minorities and religious minorities like the Hazara, Shia, and others, compared to what is offered to them by the supporters of the caliphate. So make that a permanent example. Which part of Afghanistan would you rather live in? And to interdict and destroy their remoter bases by aerial bombardment. Yes, that's something we have to keep on doing. Look, this is a NATO responsibility, backed up by a series of United Nations resolutions. If the Taliban are allowed to declare victory in Afghanistan, it means what? It means they beat the North Atlantic Treaty Organization and the United States, and the United Nations in open warfare, and can boast about it. Well, that's an outcome that's not thinkable.
What role does economics
play? And we can certainly prevent them from doing that. I doubt even now they could take the cities on their own, let alone hold them. I think that's already probably impossible. There are large tracts of Afghanistan populated by peoples who would never submit to Taliban rule. All we have to do is make sure those people don't lose. And it means the Taliban cannot win.
What role does economics play in this? The British government's, you know, all these austerity measures are cutting the defense budget, our own budget here in the United States.
The cost of it is negligible in any case. But since you mentioned economics, it's negligible. It's actually, it's again, risk signing casualties. It's negligible in point of casualties. It's not war at all. These are not warfare casualties. These are attrition casualties. These are the sort of numbers an army loses by being in existence, you know, from training accidents. It's not much worse than that. It doesn't cost a great deal. What does cost a lot is keeping some of the Karzai government going, perhaps not money well spent. Since you mentioned the economy, the main product of the Afghan economy, which is opium poppies, we insist belong to the Taliban. Why we do this, I do not know. Why we say, we insist that you have a monopoly on the production and sale of Afghan's only product is beyond me. It's the last human sacrifice we make to the Nixon doctrine of the war on drugs. And it may be the end of the enterprise. I think it's of the greatest importance we stop saying to the Afghans, we've come to liberate you, and if you will just now stand still while we burn your only cash crop. And that since we've noticed that all over the world there's a shortage of painkillers, we'll buy the stuff from you while you learn to grow other things. Of course, we should encourage diversity and make it into analgesics, which we need to do. We already pay the Turks to do this as it is. Why not give the Afghans the contract? There's such a shortage of imagination in considering this as a war of liberation and social transformation, but that's what it could be, as well as what it is, which is a test of will, that we can't lose. Thank God for Mrs. Thatcher, they used to say. as if she was, if you like, a deliverer, deus ex machina. I don't think she ever, not until her very last days, where she did show slight signs of queenliness. Not queenliness, queenliness. did she seem to think that? I think she just thought that the British people had it in them to do better than the fantastic mediocrity of the 70s. Sort of grim, dirty, rude, low productivity, resign. He used to be the most overrated man in America and running for the position of most overrated man in the world. He's now, I think, lost both simply by being himself. He's a nullity. He's a hole in the air. The triumph of Baptist rectitude, I think. The most you'd ever want to see of how perfect it can be. A great man of ideas and of action, but very rarely met in combination. A man who could write about Freud, about surrealism, about literature and art. He wrote a wonderful article called The Struggle for Cultured Speech, saying the thing that was wrong with the Russian was how full of cursing and slave talk it was. A person of heroic proportions and qualities. And for one brief time, which makes him imperishable in history, the leading rhetorical opponent and warner against both Hitler and Stalin in Europe at the same time, and a martyr to that struggle. Someone whose place in history hasn't yet been established, but the only one of the early 20th century Bolsheviks who is really worth considering is still in the 21st. Václav Havel. Perfect for my profession and yours. Ironic, understated, non-fanatical, non-violent, by folding his arms and putting a smile, a knowing smile on his face, was able to ridicule a whole edifice of totalitarianism. When the invasion of Czechoslovakia occurred in 1968, W.H. Auden was living just across the border in Austria, and he wrote a very short poem called The Ogre, which I can recite. It goes, I think, it says, the ogre does what ogres can, deeds quite impossible for man, but one prize is beyond his reach. The ogre cannot master speech. About a subjugated plain, amid the suffering and the slain, the ogre stalks with hands on hips while drivel gushes from his lips. That's 20 years before in Prague, the Civic Forum movement and its allies, by putting on plays, by writing poems, by publishing essays, by making jokes, by demonstrating the value of the written word and life lived in truth, and by nothing else, no car bombs, no bullying, no fanaticism, just brought the yoga to a halt and let the air completely out of the bag. No one who had anything to do with it or lived through that will ever, ever forget it. And the personal symbol of it will always be Vassilhavel.
Well, I think that's a fitting end.
So yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think it probably is too.